This is a continuation of the reading of the book by Richard Hoskins called War Cycles, Peace Cycles, as this content is related to the broader scope of understanding macro and geopolitics. I felt this to be appropriate to include as part of the Interchain FM podcast. Enjoy. Chapter 27, Assignment Disaster, France. On the heels of the continental disaster came the assignment disaster. From the time of John Law's Mississippi bubble in 1716 until 1789, the French went from one monetary patchwork expediency to another in the attempt to hold the mightiest country in Europe together. The usury bankers were solidly in the seat and were determined to gain control of the lands of the king, church, and nobles. The country went deeper and deeper in debt. France borrowed money for its wars, the peasants borrowed money for their crops and farms, and the aristocracy borrowed money to work their estates. Everyone borrowed to keep the wolf away. In the last few years before the revolution, the debt inflation went its predictable way. Rents were up 25%, while wages were off 25%. The very bad harvests of 1788 drove prices sky high. 11 million Frenchmen were reduced to poverty and were desperate. The bankers could make little money lending to the same old debt-ridden and hostile aristocracy. What was needed were new debt-free borrowers who had collateral. Since such borrowers did not exist, they were created. This was done, as it will always be done, as long as a single usury system exists, by financing the revolutionists. In this way, an entirely new class of debt-free borrowers was brought into existence. These created borrowers brought about the terror to deal with the large landowners who had mortgaged their estates to the lenders. They encouraged their followers to hunt propertied men with axes, to hack their limbs off, gut them, smear blood on their cheeks, and parade through the streets holding pieces of their victims' carcass and intestines over their heads. Such things could not have occurred with the Templars as France's bankers. The Templars did not charge interest, and borrowers could not owe more money than was in existence. It was forbidden. The revolutionary government at last confiscated land owned by the church, king, and aristocracy. These lands amounted to 2/3 of the nation. These lands were first used as backing for an issue of notes in December 1789. By November 1791, the assignats, or the name of the notes, had dropped in value by 18%. By August 1792, they were off minus 43% more. In August 1793, a law was passed preventing citizens from accepting the assignats at a discount. This forced circulation was backed by the death penalty. In 1794, the maximum price ceiling was repealed and prices went wild. In 1797, obligatory acceptance was abolished. The country declared a 2/3 bankruptcy of the national debt. Nothing was done to help the private debtors. Napoleon was financed by the same bankers who had financed the earlier government, and he was placed at the head of the government to bring order out of chaos. The bankers now owned much of the confiscated land. France now had a new moneyed aristocracy in addition to the military aristocracy created by Napoleon. What went wrong with the assignat issue? While the American continental tally issue was strictly paper, the French assignat tally issue was paper backed by land. This should have given it value. It didn't. The immediate cause of the failure of both the assignats and the continentals was the same. In America, the states wouldn't tax continentals out of circulation, and in France, they couldn't. The French still had their antiquated system of taxation dating back to the time of the Roman Emperor, or contract taxation. The French were the best tax dodgers in Europe. Next to the Italians, they still are. The issues of assignats continued until paper money lost all value. It would have been the same if they had issued diamonds. Too many diamonds would have flooded the market and caused their price to collapse. Again, it must be noted that because of interest, the debts were always much larger than the supply of money. Taxation, or the lack of it, will help determine the success or failure of an issue of tallies. Paper, land, wood, or gold, but any monetary system will fail in the long run as long as there is more debt than money to pay the debt. War phase heroes. War phases have their heroes. Napoleon Bonaparte, George Washington, Tom Jefferson, and Andy Jackson in the first cycle ending in 1814. Peace phases have few heroes. Just good business, bad commodity prices, booming stock markets, high unemployment, and they end with crashes and misery. The only thing that could raise the blood pressure a bit during the 1815 to 1843 peace phase was the fuss between President Andrew Jackson and Biddle of the Second Bank of the United States over who was to rule the country, not whether or not the system of interest was to rule. If Jackson won, the system existed under the direction of the politicians. If Biddle won, the system existed under the direction of the bankers. This was a battle of personalities only. It was agreed that the system was to remain whoever won. 1816, the Second Bank of the U.S. came into existence. The federal government again issued a 20-year charter to a private group of investors who formed the Second Bank of the United States. This bank was everything the first bank wasn't. It was a mammoth operation. It acted as the government's fiscal agent. It issued notes and dealt in bills of exchange. Having the ability to return state bank paper notes to the issuing bank for redemption in gold coin, it assumed the position of absolute economic master over American banks. Any bank it wished to curtail was doomed. It gathered its paper notes and presented them for gold. Any bank it wished to favor, it was lenient to. The president of the bank did not exaggerate when he boasted that the bank had a power of life or death over state banks. It used this power to gain still more power for its investors and did it at the expense of other sections of the country, as we shall soon see. 1816, March 22nd. Feeling apprehension over the actions of the newly created interest banks, Matthew Carey wrote the following to the directors of the Second Bank of the U.S. The plan adopted by the banks was to make money scarce by a sudden and violent curtailment of discounts. They are literally masters of the destinies of those of their debtors not intolerably independent in circumstances. They may at pleasure reduce some to bankruptcy, and maybe undue accommodations enable others to make great fortunes out of the distresses of the public. When money is plenty, they entice men to use their capital. When money is scarce, they withdraw it and become absolute masters of their fellow citizens. 1817. The American Colonization Society was formed in Washington, D.C. Its purpose, to finance the return of African Americans to Africa. Its founder, Reverend Robert Finney, a Presbyterian minister. The reason? Israel was to separate themselves from strangers lest they learn their ways. The group immediately came under attack from the liberals of the usury banking interests who wanted the slaves freed and kept in America so that they could borrow money into existence. 1819. The Second Bank issued all of its supply of specie to any and all of its cronies and friends who wished to convert paper notes into gold and faced bankruptcy. In a frantic effort to get liquid, it called on the bank's debtors to pay these loans immediately. The interest plus principal equaled more than the floating supply of money. Most debtors could not pay. They went bankrupt by the thousands. America plunged into the crash of 1819. Many of the western towns built in the boom of 1816 to 1818 were abandoned in the panic of 1819. 1831, February 2nd. Senator Thomas Hart Benton of Missouri offered a resolution against rechartering the bank. Quote, I am informed that the notes of the banks south of the Potomac and Ohio, even those of the lower Mississippi, are generally refused at the United States branch bank in St. Louis and, in consequence, are expelled from circulation in Missouri and Illinois and in the neighboring districts. This exclusion of the southern notes from the northwest quarter of the Union is injurious to both parties, as our travelers and immigrants chiefly come from the south, and the whole of our trade goes there to find a cash market. The exclusion is general and extends to the banks in Virginia, the two Carolinas, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, and Louisiana. It fastens a vampire on the bosom of the state to snatch away its gold and silver. These states, without rice, without cotton, without tobacco, without sugar, and with less flour and provisions to export, are saturated with gold and silver, while the southern and western states, with all the real sources of wealth, are in a state of the utmost destitution. For this, the Bank of the United States stand forth preeminently culpable. A statement in the National Intelligencer of this morning exults on the quantity of gold and silver in the vaults of the United States Bank. It declares that the institution to be overburdened with gold and silver, and well may it be so overburdened since it has lifted the load entirely from the South and West. The bank needs friends in Congress and in the presidential chair. Its fate, its very existence, may often depend upon the friendship of the president and Congress. And in such cases, it is not in human nature to avoid using the immense means in the hands of the bank to influence the elections of these officers, of usury at the rate of 46%. What an interest in keeping those away might suffer the bank harm. If these banks are beneficial institutions, why not several? If malignant, why create one? Eternal drawing out and no bring back is a process which no people, no country can endure. So will any people be exhausted of their wealth, no matter how great that wealth may be, whose miserable destiny shall subject them to a system which is forever levying and never refunding? 1832, February 2nd. Representative Augustine Clayton of Georgia commented, quote, "The amount of gold and silver coin and bullion sent from Western and Southern branches of the parent bank since its establishment in 1817 is supposed to be 15 or 20 millions and, with bank interest on bank debts, constitutes a system of the most intolerable oppression of the South and West." In spite of the opposition of the Second Bank, President Jackson won a stunning victory over Henry Clay in the presidential contest of 1832. This kept the office of president free from bank control until Fillmore's election in 1849. After Jackson was elected, he discovered that the Second Bank had almost doubled its loans from $42 million in January 1831 to $70 million in May 1832 in an effort to bring numerous new borrowers under its control. The borrower is servant. The bank was careful to warn its debtors of the ruin which might overtake them if Jackson were re-elected. In addition, Jackson discovered that some of the largest sums were lent on very unusual terms to owners of newspapers. These papers, of course, took Clay's side in the election. This infuriated Jackson. He determined to weaken the bank by removing public monies from the Second Bank and depositing them in state banks. The Second Bank, in an attempt to turn the people against Jackson by creating hard times, called on debtors to pay their loans. A panic ensued. The public turned their hostility against the bank instead of against Jackson. The bank became alarmed by this turn of events. They relented and extended the loans. 1835. There was a crop failure. The farmers who had borrowed to buy their farms and to pay interest on their mortgages went to the wall. Jackson made matters worse. He took money out of circulation by paying the national debt down to zero and didn't spend new money back into circulation. 1836. The charter of the Second Bank expired. The worst of all things happened, a second crop failure. It was all over for the farmer. Progressively lower prices for commodities combined with 2 years of crop failure did it. Meanwhile, in Texas, the Mexicans stormed the Alamo and exterminated its defenders. At the Battle of Goliad, Colonel Fanning surrendered with 520 men. All but six were massacred. Americans' opinions about Mexican strangers began to harden. The crash of 1837. The crash of 1837 was the inevitable result of the peak in commodity prices in 1814. There was the temporary panic of 1819, engineered by the Second Bank of the U.S. calling in loans. But after that was over, America went right back to borrowing 10 and agreeing to repay 11. Total debt soared. America was on a land buying spree. The amount of land changing hands was astounding, as it is at every peak in land prices. 1834, 4.6 million acres. 1835, 12.6 million acres. 1836, 20 million acres. The total acreage traded was up by 425% in 3 years. Lots in Bangor, Maine, which were 300 in 1831, brought almost 1,000 in 1836. The London Rothschilds are said to have been the biggest factor. Many states repudiated their debts. The farmer walked away from their neat, well-tended farms and let them grow up in brush. Those farms the bank owners didn't want were thrown on the auction block for what they could get for them. This started the land crash. Early in 1837, 9/10 of the eastern factories were closed. Philip Hone wrote, "No man can calculate to escape ruin, but he who owes no money. Happy is he who has little and is free from debt." In May, all banks suspended converting their banknotes into gold. 600 banks broke down. New interest banks were forming so rapidly that the decrease really doesn't show up on the history chart. To help debtors who were being abused and imprisoned, Congress copied the old Roman bankruptcy law and called it the Federal Bankruptcy Law. This wiped out $450 million of debts that were non-collectible. After taking everything the debtors had, it allowed them to start borrowing money into existence again. The new borrowing was more valuable than the old worthless debt. In contrast to the rest of the country, the government itself was in fine shape. It owed no money and was servant to no one. When it needed money, it simply printed and spent it into circulation. Between 1838 and 1843, 7 issues of Treasury notes totaling $47 million were printed. 1840, President Tyler vetoed another attempt to establish a national bank. While chaos had enveloped the mainstream of commerce, in the backwaters life was still relatively tranquil. Samuel E. Mayo of Virginia recalled that for generations, it was considered fashionable not to raise horses for money, but they were kept and run just to keep up the stock. No betting was allowed on the races. The same went for borrowing money, and the prohibition against gambling and usury was still obeyed in large areas of the country. As a consequence of this obedience, they were protected from the miseries afflicting the usury banking regions of the rest of the country. 1841, October 11th. The Second Bank of the United States failed. The long list of foreign stockholders was made public. 1842. The new abolitionists, the spiritual descendants of the French revolutionists, were bankrolled to replace the plantation owners as the nation's rulers. They became venomous in their attack on the South. The original abolitionist movement, the American Colonization Society, was based on the biblical law of separation. It was formed by Virginians in Washington in 1817. Gaining members and finances, they began buying up slaves and sending them back to Africa as colonists. The first shipload left on the Elizabeth in 1819. To aid in the eventual repatriation of all African Americans from America, Charles Mercer and John Floyd of Virginia left the effort to have a bill passed to have armed cruisers stationed off Africa and America to disrupt the slave trade to America. Needing new borrowers and spurred by this American example, Britain in 1833 abolished slavery and borrowed $20 million into existence to compensate their owners. No provision was made to return African Americans to Africa. To have done so would have defeated the purpose of their emancipation. The new abolitionists from the Northeast were sponsored by, and were agents of, the banking interests. They made no bones about what they wanted. They didn't want the African slaves sent back to Africa. They wanted them freed with no compensation to their owners, and they wanted them kept here in the United States. 3 million new potential borrowers added to the population at one time. The potential profits staggered the imagination. The main obstacle to the spread of the interest banking system was the debt-free southern plantation system that sent debt-free anti-central bank legislators to Washington. The self-sufficient plantation was made possible by the originally unwanted slave. If the slaves were freed with no compensation, it would destroy the plantation system, the debt-free owners, and the southern opposition all at the same time. To give compensation would be to leave the former slave owners debt-free and independent and in their same old powerful position. It would allow them to continue their opposition to the Northeast banks. In a usury system, a freed slave is free only to borrow money into existence, not to leave. Later on in the chapter on African colonization, we will examine what happens to Africans who rebel and try to return to their African homeland on their own in defiance of the bankers' politicians.